The Old Testament reading for this, the fifth Sunday after the Epiphany, is taken from the book of Job, the seventh chapter. Job says, "Does not man have hard service on earth? Are not his days like those of a hired man, like a slave longing for the evening shadows, or a hired man waiting eagerly for his wages? So I have been allotted months of futility, and nights of misery have been assigned to me. When I lie down, I think, how long before I get up? The night drags on, and I toss till dawn. My body is clothed with worms and scabs. My skin is broken and festering. My days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle, and they come to an end without hope. Remember, O God, that my life is but a breath. My eyes will never see happiness again." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So I can preach there also. That is why I have come. So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. Here ends the gospel. Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We continue our track through the Epiphany season. Epiphany, of course, falling on January 6th with the celebration of the coming of the Magi, the wise men, to bring their gifts to the Christ child. And we've been hearing ever since this time that this is Epiphany. That word means manifestation, or to make known, or to reveal. We've been seeing in various ways how that has happened. We saw, of course, not only the Magi, as they confess Christ as a Savior and as the promised one with their gifts, but also we saw in the presentation of our Lord in Simeon's word that he's now seen the salvation of the Lord when he sees the Christ child. We saw it also then, of course, in the baptism of our Lord, both visibly and audibly, as we heard voice from heaven say, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased." And as we saw, the Holy Spirit descend as a dove. And here, the last couple Sundays, we've been hearing from Mark's Gospel of Jesus's healing ministry as he has healed those who are afflicted with various diseases, and also his driving out of demons. And that requires some special discussion, I think. It is an interesting fact that you do not see demon possession in the Old Testament. You think about it, it's only when Jesus himself is on our earth doing his ministry, heading to the cross, that you begin to see all this demon possession. I think that's because Satan likes to imitate God. Remember the famous number 666, right? Well, what is that referencing? That's three times falling short of God's perfect number of seven. And so Satan tries to be like God, wants to be God, but he can't be God. And so he does the best he can as he imitates and mocks God. And demon possession is part of that mocking, I think. With the coming of Christ, God has taken on human flesh. The Son of God has become man for us men and for our salvation, as we confessed a few moments ago. The Son of God is both God and man in one person. We confess that in the Nicene Creed, very God, and yet born of the Virgin Mary. And Satan can't do that, so the next best thing that he can do is demon possession, as he has his demons, fallen angels, take possession of human beings. And so it's not surprising that it's in the New Testament that you see this. You don't see this in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, it's all over the place. Jesus, of course, manifests his glory that he is God come in the flesh by driving these demons out. And so you have both this healing ministry of Christ, and why? What's the necessity of healing? Both of these things, by the way, come back to Satan in the fall, right? What's the necessity of a healing ministry? Because it's a fallen world. People get sick, people have problems, people die because of the fall. The day you eat of it, you shall surely die. God warns Adam and Eve, and they don't listen, but instead they listen to Satan and put themselves in league with the great tempter. And it is interesting, I was mentioning this in Bible class, that You don't really have a justification text here. This is not talking about the cross, but it, again, in a sense, it still is. That the cross, the necessity of Jesus dying to pay for our sins, is because of the fall. The evidence of the fall, of course, is all around us as we see death and illness, and then in Jesus' time in a very specific way with the demon possession that's going on. These are the result of Adam and Eve's sin and of our sin as we follow in their footsteps. Jesus has come to undo that. His healing ministry is saying that. It's not his just him being nice. He was nice. He loved people. He wanted to help people. But there was much more going on here. This was pointing forward to what Jesus had actually come to accomplish. And the first thing, of course, that ultimately has to be accomplished is the penalty of our sin and paying for that. And Jesus will go on his way to do that. But he's giving these foretastes, these previews of things to come as he heals and restores health to what it will be like when he returns again in the new heavens and the new earth, where we will no longer battle with illness, sickness, disease, addiction, whatever you name it, whatever befuddles us and befalls us will be taken away. It is interesting that Jesus then does not want the confession of the demons. Did you notice it again? We heard it last Sunday. We hear it again in this reading. He drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Now, Mark adds this little bit about he goes to this solitary place where he prays, and the disciples come looking for him and says, everyone's looking for you. Come on, go do your thing for them, right? And he replies, we've got to go elsewhere. Because although Christ has come to do these signs to point to himself as the Messiah, as the one who has been promised, as the Savior of the world, he still has a job to do, and that is to go to the cross. And so he wouldn't stay in any one place for very long, because that would get in the way of his mission of going to the cross. He does not want the demons' confession, because that would people had misunderstandings. They were misconstruing what the Messiah was coming to do. Some of them thought he was coming to be a bread king, to provide for all their needs temporally in this life. That's the main thing. And so after he feeds the 5,000, they want him to stay around. They kind of like that, you know. Hey, he's a good cook. He can come. You know? But again, he has other things he has to go do. But also with the demons and their confession, he didn't just kind of, I think if you've been in my Bible class, I make a big point about this. He doesn't go around kind of spoon-feeding people and telling them right out front, I'm the Savior, I'm the Messiah. But rather what he does is he does all these things to lead people to that confession and to put their faith in him. And so he does not want the demons' confession. And he tells them to be quiet. If you read on in Mark, he heals one person and he tells them not to reveal it. And the guy goes around blabbing to everybody. And it makes it more difficult for Jesus to get around again. So you see this in Mark's gospel very clearly. But he does not want the demons' confession. This is, again, epiphany, manifestation. He's shown who he is and what he's done. He doesn't want the demons' confession, but it's epiphany, and it's also time to stress missions. He does want your confession, my confession. He does not tell us to be quiet. Rather, he tells us, go make disciples of all nations. He wants us to speak in his behalf, all of us, wherever he has placed us in life, however we can do that, whatever that looks like, he wants to use us as his instruments to bring the message of what he has done for us, the salvation he has won for us, for all people, to everyone. That is his desire. The connection between this manifestation imagery or epiphany and this mission emphasis is that what he has manifested, not only is he God, that's great, but what? God for you. God come for you to go to the cross, to pay for your sin, to undo the results of the fall, to undo what Satan has brought into this world for us men and for our salvation. He has come down. And that, then, is what inspires our desire to serve him and do mission. You see it, by the way, in the text. It just kind of barely mentions it, but I think it's significant. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told Jesus about her. So he went to her, took her hand, and helped her up. He healed her. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. There's nothing you and I can give to God that God doesn't have, but God wants to use us. She begins to wait on them. She wants to be an instrument for the Lord. And the more that you realize what Christ has done for you, the more you want to serve him. In fact, the hymn we sang said that in kind of the reverse coin side of it, so to speak. Verse 6, "And none, O Lord, have perfect rest, for none are wholly free from sin." We're all infected with this disease called original sin. "And they who fain would serve thee best are conscious most of wrong within." So I'll put it in modern English. Those who want to serve best are those who are most conscious of their sin, of what Christ has done for us. Norman Neagle, one of my favorite professors, used to say, "Big sin, big Jesus. Little sin, little Jesus." He had a great way of saying things. The size of your Jesus, how important Jesus is to you, depends on how much you think he's done for you. If you're just a little sinner and you don't think you don't have that much need, Jesus doesn't mean that much to you. If you recognize your sinfulness, then Jesus is everything to you. Jesus says this when the woman anoints his feet and wipes them with her hair, and remember the Pharisees get upset, and he says that she loves much. She's forgiven because she loved much. And some churches get this wrong. They think that means because she loves so much, she gets to be forgiven. That's not what Jesus is saying. He's saying the fact that she was forgiven, and she knows it, is shown in the abundance of her love. In other words, our good works are a result of faith. Our good works are a result of knowing what Christ has done for us. We have a big Jesus. And because we have a big Jesus, he is able to work in us mightily to do his will in this life, to be his instruments, to bring the gospel to others. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus always.